Hi everyone, can y'all hear me?
Yeah.
All right. So, I'd like to begin tonight by asking you all to think of something for me. So I'd like you to remember a time when an elected official, someone who supposedly represents you, did something or voted for something that you strongly disagreed with. And it made you angry and you thought, I need to do something about this. You may not have to think too far back to find one of these. But if you do, then think about a time when an elected official did something that you strongly agreed with. And you thought, this person needs a pat on the back. I need to let them know how I feel. Maybe you. All right, so you have this moment in your head. Now, be honest with yourself. Did you actually do anything? Did you take the time to act on that impulse, to contact a legislator, or to make your voice heard on that issue? So I see some nodding heads, so I know this room is above average. But if national odds held, then 1 in 100 of you would have taken action. 1 in 100. And this is a problem for these organizations. These are issue advocacy nonprofits with a mission to mobilize action in support of a political, social, or environmental cause. And a crucial element of their strategy is to mobilize the millions of Americans who care passionately about that cause, but maybe need a little nudge to take action. And the tools that they currently use, email and social media, are increasingly ineffective on mobilizing that action, particularly for the younger generations. These organizations are eager for a new tool that will more effectively attract, mobilize, and retain millennial supporters. They're eager for civic rights. So what is civic rights? Well, one way to think about it is civic rights is kind of like the Fitbit of civic engagement. And to help you understand what that means, I'll show you our smartphone app that individuals download and use to subscribe to these organizations that represent causes they support. Through the app, they receive calls to action, and this action could be to contact a legislator or to RSVP to an event, with including context and information on why this action is important and why now. They're able to easily complete this action through the app, report back to the organization, track their actions over time, share that with friends, and build an online social community of fellow informed and active citizens. So organizations now are able to mobilize action at a rate of about 1.8% through email. And through CivicRise, they're mobilizing action at a rate of 15%, which is 8 times better than their current best alternative. So CivicRise is furthering a social cause, but we are also a for-profit venture. And our target customers of these issue advocacy organizations represent a $26 billion industry. And they're nonprofits, but they invest in technology that helps them scale and achieve their mission. About 10% of this technology spend is on communications tools, and it's this $90 million market segment that we initially seek to address. But this is just the first step, because with a growing, engaged user base of active citizens, we're looking ahead at the 2018 and 2020 elections as key opportunities for further growth. And so how will we achieve this growth? Well, here's where we're starting. We're starting with state-level partnerships. Our customer partners so far are folks like Democracy North Carolina, the North Carolina League of Conservation Voters, organizations with a headquarters in the Triangle and a statewide reach. And we're hoping to leverage these partnerships into national-level relationships with organizations with a wider footprint and a more substantial user base. And as we continue to scale, our next step is to automate the account setup process, allowing any organization across the U.S. who meet certain criteria and a level of legitimacy to create an account and mobilize their supporters in support of their cause through civic rights. And at the same time, we need to be increasing our user base. So our users right now are predominantly coming from these partnerships. We're going to continue that. And also, we're reaching new people through social media and advertising. But open data. So this is the important thing for tonight. How does civic rights use open data? Well, civic rights is built on a foundation of this data. In 2 primary categories, the first being legislator data. So we are pulling information from the Google Civic Information API, which allows us to input a user's address and then return a list of all elected representatives associated with that user, including their names, their positions, their contact information. And it's by running this through the app that we're able to connect users directly with their elected representatives on the causes they care about. Removing any of that, looking up phone numbers, looking up emails, we make that process streamlined through this open data. And then the second piece, so this legislator data is already what we have functional in the app. The second piece we're just starting to break ground on, this is voter registration, voter history, and elections data. So your voter registration status and the number of times you've voted is public record, and this information is available from the state board of elections and the county level boards of election. What we're hoping to do is, through Civic Rise, be able to inform a given user whether or not they're registered to vote at their current address, and if they're not, to guide them through the process of registering, and once they are, to inform them when the next election is, who's on the ballot, and how and when they vote, and then send them notifications up to the election day to encourage them to actually make it to the polls. Because this contacting a legislator on an issue you care about is vital, but it's only relevant if that legislator is listening. And to make sure that legislator is listening, you have to be voting. And so this is a crucial piece of what we're trying to do with Civic Rise. My name is Tim. I'm a co-founder of Civic Rise, a recent graduate of Duke's MBA program with 10 years experience working in the nonprofit sector, including with and for these target customers. And my partner, Tobias McNulty, is a software developer and has previously co-founded and run a successful web app development shop here in the Triangle. And we founded Civic Rise with the goal of mobilizing 1 million actions in our first year. So this is a lofty goal, and we have a long way to go to get there. And we're going to need help. And so we're seeking connections, thank you, to folks, executives and board members at nonprofits who may be interested in using Civic Rise to mobilize their base. And we'd love to chat with folks who have experience working with this Board of Elections data, understanding how we can best implement that into Civic Rise in our next phase. We're going to need your help to achieve this goal. And so I'm going to close today with the question that we put to our users every day. And that question is, are you ready to take action? Thank you. Questions?
I'll throw a quick one at you, which is one of our criteria here is progress since September. So what's been the, what have you been up to?
Yeah, so my son was born 2 weeks ago. So that's
congratulations. So that counts. It's a 6 out of 5.
So the main thing that we're focusing on the moment is user growth. So we have these 10 organization partnerships that we're working with. And so we're focusing now on growing the user base and understanding are the users actually maintaining engagement? Because if they aren't, then we have a problem. And if they are, which we have shown so far, then that means that we're able to take this MVP that we have and scale it. So we've just been focusing on increasing that user base and growing that week over week percentage.
So you have 10 partners now?
Yes.
Okay. And how many users?
Just over 600.
And what's the engagement thing?
It's been, so we've sort of been evolving the platform as we go. So as of now, about a third of the people who have created an account are still with us. A third of them took some actions and still have the app but are less engaged, and we're figuring out how to re-engage those folks. And about a third download the app, and then we lost them.
I have a question about scaling. can everybody hear me okay? Okay. I'll speak louder. There. So this is a question about scaling. So, unfortunately, I worked on a project using National Secretary of State data, and I found high variability in a lack of standardization in Secretary of State data. I've also had some experience with Board of Election data, same problem. How are you going to handle the disparate variety, quality, and way that the data is structured among all these different states as you scale up?
Yeah, that is certainly going to be one of our largest challenges, I think. Okay. So right now we're pulling information, like I mentioned, from the Google Civic Information API, and they do a great job of curating and cleaning the data that they run through. They only cover some elections, though. They don't cover every election.
Sure.
So as we move forward, we can provide the legislative contact information on a national basis. And this voter registration, voter encouragement side of things, we're going to focus exclusively on North Carolina so that we have a way to get a handle on that data and understand what it is, what that process looks like of implementing that data. And then we'll be better able to answer that question about how we scale it.
So how do you see the counterbalance with what I like to term as the hack houses, i.e. the Facebook influence messaging, which clearly has proven strong in the market over the last election cycle? So how do you actually really see this? You played that down a bit during your presentation, and do you feel like this is you've got an appropriate counterbalance to those?
Counterbalance to sort of the social media news.
$100,000 on a few ads to influence their populace in strategic areas to influence election results.
Right. Yeah, I think so. Our initial users are the people that see that and recognize it for what it is and want a direct connection to trusted advisors on the issues. So they're folks that are willing to